you're stuck in your bubble and you don't want to admit it. You've worked so hard to get where you are, and there's reasonable speculation.
You're not wrong for not immediately adopting this.
You're right. You're probably making the right call, but even if we took a time machine back, guys, folks, this is what's going to happen. I don't even know if they could capture it.
Innovator's dilemma.
Exactly. Like, revenue plummets. Stock price goes down. Everyone quits. We're going to replace our expensive outside salespeople with cheap inside people. People are going to be pissed. Even if you knew it's coming, that's the innovator's dilemma.
Now, this is why I'm like so excited to talk about this and shift to AI.
All right.
I love that slide in.
So let me start off with some data. And let's look back like 25 years when we had a massive technology shift in software from on-premise software, where it's like you buy like a floppy disk or CD, you install the software on a server or CPU that you own locally, versus the shift to the cloud, where you now access your products and applications through the internet, right? So that was a pretty massive shift. I often like play a game with audiences. I'll say, okay, the number one CRM market share provider in 1995 was Siebel. Raise your hand if you use Siebel.
I don't even know what it is.
Right. Like, raise your hand if you use HubSpot or Salesforce.com. Everyone's hands go up. Repeat that with HR software. The number one provider in 1995 in the on-premise era was PeopleSoft. Today it's Workday. In the IT DevOps arena, it was BMC. Now it's ServiceNow. In the ERP category, it was SAP. Now it's NetSuite. Okay, so case in point, you've got some interesting data points that show that as you go through a massive technology shift, in this case, from on-premise software to cloud software, most of the market share creation is captured by the new companies, the cloud-based companies. And when you look at each category, leadership changes from an on-premise native company to a cloud native company. Why does that happen, Matthew?
Innovator's dilemma.
Exactly. I'm naming a paradigm that's happening, but why does that happen? So this is actually a really cool story because I had I was throwing a limited partner meeting for Stage 2 Capital a year ago. And we actually did it in the Salesforce Tower in San Francisco. I had the Q&A keynote speaker with a gentleman, David Schmeier, that had just sold his company to Salesforce and was the chief product officer. And he's one of the early co-founders of Siebel. So yeah, what better person to speak to about this? Now, we had some conversations preparing for it, and I won't quote him directly, but like, the conversation was something like this. If we rewind the clock to like the mid-90s in Siebel, it's like, okay, everyone, we're crushing it. We're the market leader, this new CRM category. Things are going great. And someone was just like, hey, there's this internet thing that Al Gore invented 40 years ago that like we probably should pay attention to. Let's have a strategy. Someone's like, okay, like let's hire a consulting company and they can evaluate for us. And the consulting company comes back and says, all right, we just did the evaluation. It's gonna cost you like $500 million to rebuild the product on the cloud. Big expense. Number two, we just interviewed like 1,000 CTOs and none of them said they would ever put their data in the cloud. It's just not secure. So why would you spend $500 million to go after a very small opportunity? Now then Mark Benioff quits Oracle, starts Salesforce. Where does he start off? Not with the big CTOs and big companies, very small businesses that want a competitive edge. And like, yeah, I'll do this. Wow, I don't have to buy Siebel. I don't have to do any installation. I don't have to own any servers. I can pay you like $5,000 a year and have a CRM. Great. And then all of a sudden, like some big company tries it and they save a ton of money and it works. And now they start getting a competitive edge. Now all the other big companies and all those CTOs were wrong. They actually, AWS comes around, turns out the data is actually secure in the cloud and they can take advantage of all the advantages of that architecture, of the pricing and of the distribution. I bet even if Siebel knew the right answer, it, like we took a time machine back to 1995 and said, guys, folks, this is what's gonna happen. I don't even know if they could capture it.
That's what I'm wondering is like, I wonder if it's more common to like to freeze of like, I don't know the answer. I'm either like completely disrupting my company that like it could fail and we're done, or I just keep doing what I'm doing, but I know it's not going to work long term.
It's both layers. Like I think more of it's just like you're stuck in your bubble and you don't want to admit it. And you've worked so hard to get where you are. And there's reasonable speculation. CTOs didn't want to put their data in the cloud. It seemed very reasonable at the time.
Yeah, you're not wrong for not immediately adopting this.
You're right. You're probably making the right call. But even if we took a time machine back and said, no, you are wrong. This is where it's going. It's like, okay, fine. Like, we're going to change our pricing from $5 million to like $500,000 a year. Like, revenue plummets. Stock price goes down. Everyone quits. We're going to replace our expensive outside salespeople with cheap inside people. Our culture is going to go to, like, people are going to be pissed. Even if you knew it's coming, that's the innovator's dilemma.
Now, this is why I'm, like, so excited to talk about this and shift to AI. Because this is, like, this is the moment right now that I think a lot of companies are facing.
So over the last year, we've shifted eras. We've shifted from the early co-pilot AI era to the agentic AI era. Okay, so as opposed to like, hey, you're a support person and this is how you do a job. Now you have this AI co-pilot and you do support tickets 20% faster. In the agentic era, it's like, hey, here's an AI agent, support agent, and they'll take care of the tickets for you. Okay, so a lot more disruptive. And so that's an important observation for this type of disruption is it usually follows the Gartner hype cycle. Okay, and so what happens is like a new technology becomes evident, like the breakthrough in November of 2022 and when ChatGPT took off, right? Everyone's like, whoa, this is powerful. And all the visionaries are like, okay, this changes the world. And everybody starts paying 1,000x on revenue for an AI company. That's called the hype cycle. Remember 1999? We've got plenty of examples. Pets.com, Webvan, you pick them. Google was not the first search engine, right? So you've got this hype cycle where we confuse an iteration with a disruption. We think it's a disruption, it's actually an iteration. And you have a massive destruction of the early investment. And we saw that last year, year and a half, in a lot of the co-pilot area. Is the agentic AI the actual disruption or is it more hype? We don't know. It seems like it's closer to disruption. But usually what happens is you have a hype, you have a crash, and then you have sustainable growth. Okay, so in 1999, massive hype. Then we crashed in 2001. Unfortunately for that one, it affected the public market. So that was massive. It caused a recession. No one was doing startups anymore. Venture capital bottomed out. But every once in a while in 2004, 2005, 2006, great time to start a company. There's not a lot of VC. There's not a lot of competition for employees. Guess what year HubSpot started? 2005, 2006. Really great business. Same with Salesforce, same with NetSuite, same with ServiceNow. Like, so these crashes are great times to start companies. And then you have sustainable growth. And now you look at the public equities and in tech, they're dominated by these cloud first companies, right? So the first era of the AI co-pilot was probably the hype. Now we're in agentic. Is it disruptive? I don't know, but let's play around with some ideas. So I've used a lot of different inputs to like gain conviction on some of these narratives. First off, like I've evaluated like over 1,000 native AI startups in the last year. Like it's just our job. It's stage two capital and venture capital. Look at this stuff. I also have the luxury of like traveling around, talking to people. As an example, a couple of months ago, every January I take 50 Harvard Business School students to Silicon Valley for a class that I teach called Disrupting Silicon Valley with AI. And we meet awesome people. We met the CEO of NVIDIA, the head of sales at OpenAI, chief business officer at Perplexity. We met the CEO of Waymo. We met with Yamini, the CEO here at HubSpot. We met the CEO of LinkedIn. We met the chief strategy officer at Adobe. And you start to like hear some really cool patterns and thoughts from these great visionaries who are living in this thing. Okay, so here's a couple of those narratives that might be innovators' dilemmas as we move to AI. So the future organization may go from a set of humans that are relatively specialized to conduct a frontline function, let's say sales. You have SDRs that set appointments, account executives that close appointments, CSMs that make those customers successful. And they are replaced by a string of hyper-specialized AI agents. And those AI agents are trained by humans to the context of the business and then managed potentially by humans, at least in the first phase. So let's just look at sales, for example. So you have one AI agent that does the analysis on the historic customer base, close rates, LTV, churn, retention, and calculates your ICP and reevaluates that every week. They pass that information to another agent that goes and finds accounts that match that ICP that you're not currently penetrating. They pass that information to another agent that finds the 3 to 5 most relevant contacts and employees at those accounts that are related to your decision-making unit and purchasing your product. They pass that information to another agent that constructs the ideal personalized outbound sequence to get each contact's attention based on who they are, their role, their interests, etc. They pass that information to another agent that delivers that information through the appropriate medium. They pass that to another agent, and so on, right? So you've got this sequence of agents that are doing these functions. That's a pretty massive shift to an organization. So where are the innovators' dilemmas in there? Well, a lot of information in that sequence of agents is working on unstructured data. Now, most, both on-premise and cloud-native, SaaS-native businesses had to start their technical architecture with a single database structure. You know, like we know what is a HubSpot, we know what is Salesforce, we know what is Workday, and it had to apply to every single company. So they are reliant on a structured database architecture. And yet, the way these agents are working is they're working in a very unstructured data role. That might be a complicated architectural shift. Furthermore, there's no more data input in this situation. So much of the SaaS, the native cloud providers, invested a ton in great user interface so that sellers can input data, so that programmers can deploy code, so that finance people can input financial information. But yet in this agentic world, there's not really much reliance on data input. So that makes a lot of these architectures irrelevant. And that clean slate architectural opportunity may be similar to the Siebel story we just walked through of a massive architectural shift. All right, number two, let's think about how these organizations run. Like, just imagine the future organization of the example I gave in sales, and that same example exists in product and engineering, and that same example exists in finance. You have a lot more productivity per employee. There are memes of like having the first $1 billion company with one employee. It could be possible. We're seeing evidence of some founders doing more with 2 people than they used to be able to 200. And so if you're going to move to that new organizational design and exploit even this early AI capability, it is so much easier to do that as a startup than as a big company that has to manage the cultural shift. It may take that shift so long that the native AI attacker with this new organizational design gets to the right answer faster. So there's a hypothesis that more innovators' dilemmas, more disruption, may not come from the impact on the product offering, but on the impact on how the internal organization works, how they build product, how they sell product, how they account for product. Number three idea I'll throw out there, we could have another pricing one. In the same way that we went from perpetual licenses to cloud, and that was very difficult for the incumbents to capture, there's a big movement around outcome-based pricing, right? So instead of paying on a per subscription, like $100 a month or $10,000 a year, you know, you pay us $5 every time we put out a support ticket, right? So that's a great deal for buyers because they can essentially lock in the ROI on how their business runs, but extremely disruptive to an incumbent who already has financial forecasts and revenue forecasts that are dictated on their legacy pricing structure. So that could be tricky.
If I am one of the incumbents right now and I'm leading that company, what do I need to be thinking of? How do I need to be acting? What should I be looking for right now?
Yeah, you should be hypothesizing around what those are and you should be trying to disrupt yourself. And like, what's different about this time in 2025 than in 2000, 2001, 2002 is this work is much more known and more rigorously understood. And so I think our incumbent executives are far more educated. They're probably less like the Siebel folks who are like, oh, it's not gonna happen. I think they're far more paranoid. But like we said in the Siebel, even if you knew, what are you gonna do about it?
Right.
So it's a tough call. I mean, if I were advising them, and I'm certainly not an expert in this arena, but strategies that I've seen that I think are interesting is to quadruple down on corp dev, meaning go out and invest in the companies that might disrupt you, that might give you early insight into what those trends might be. So you can choose between either how can we encapsulate that in our organization or how can we buy these people and get them ahead of the market. That's pretty good. Other things I've seen that I know HubSpot's doing is starting sort of skunk works teams to try to disrupt themselves. I think that's a smart strategy. It's like, get the heck out of the office. You all are smart, like 0-to-1 engineers, product people. Go redefine CRM or whatever your category is from the ground up. Don't pay attention to our customer base. Don't pay attention to our tech stack. Just do it from the ground up and try to disrupt yourself. And that is like usually Professor Christensen's piece of advice on how to manage this. Just to recap on the innovator's dilemma. Basically what the innovator's dilemma means is when we go through a massive tech shift, like we went through with on-premise to cloud and what we are probably going through as we go from cloud to AI, these innovator dilemmas come up where a native startup attacker can actually exploit the opportunity faster and more effectively than the incumbent trying to evolve over. We give a bunch of examples in the shift from on-prem to cloud, and we also give a bunch of examples as we move from cloud to potential AI. Number two, if you're a native AI attacker, make sure you distinguish between an iteration and a disruption. A lot of the co-pilots were iterations. It was too easy for the foundational models to integrate up and too easy for the current incumbents to integrate sideways to eat up your opportunity. Look for true disruptions. They may be here in the agentic AI shift. Number three, if you're an incumbent, be very paranoid. We shared a lot of historical data that there aren't many category leaders that survived the last shift, and it's expected that they won't survive this shift either. Thankfully, to Professor Christensen's credit, executives and incumbents are far more educated this time. You can use techniques like quadrupling down on corp dev to get a sense of what the native AI attackers are doing, or maybe even start a native AI attacker within your own walls to try to disrupt themselves. Either way, people are speculating that AI is the technology of our generation. It's the technology of centuries and centuries of human existence. I agree, it's an exciting time. I can't wait to see how it unfolds. I'm Marc Roberge, this is The Science of Scaling. I didn't need that last part, right? What do you want me to do at the end?
I think that's great.
What do you want me to do at the end?
I think it's fine.
Okay, that's it, see you later.